Hi, today I'm going to talk about Shadow, running Tor in a box for accurate and efficient experimentation. I'm going to talk about a tool that we've developed that will help easily run Tor experiments on a single machine. I'm Rob Jansen from the U.S. Naval Research Lab. I'm also currently a PhD candidate at the University of Minnesota. This is joint work with my advisor, Nick Hopper, also from the University of Minnesota. So Tor is an anonymous communication system. The way a client uses Tor is he sends his message through a series of Tor relays called a Tor circuit. Okay. These relays are located around the world, and as this message gets forwarded along these relays until finally the last relay in the circuit forwards the message to the server. So the server thinks the message came from one of the Tor relays, and so he is unable to determine the identity of the client. And no single relay in this circuit will be able to determine both the client and the server. So the client and the server remain unlinkable. Okay. Tor is an extremely popular anonymous communication system, servicing between 500,000 and 1 million users. Since Tor is so popular, it's also a popular research system. Okay. There have been lots of proposals on ways to improve both Tor's performance and security. So new algorithms and protocols that are proposed need a way to test out these ideas before adding them into the Tor network. Because Tor services so many users, and these users are usually using Tor for sensitive reasons, it's important that we don't compromise their anonymity. Okay. So far, there's been no standard experimentation approach. Researchers often employ techniques such as simulation or emulation, or they run experiments on distributed systems such as Plant Lab. But so far, there hasn't been a standard approach for testing new Tor ideas. Okay. One caveat here is a recent system called Experiment Tor, which uses a slightly different approach than we've taken, and I don't have time to get into the details. So we're proposing Tor in a box using the Shadow simulator. Shadow is a discrete event network simulator. Shadow is different from most network simulators in that it natively executes real applications, such as Tor. Okay, so it's a simulator, so it does simulate time. It does simulate network and cryptographic operations. It also includes an accurate CPU delay model by taking measurements of code execution, it can accurately characterize the delays, processing delays of the application. Shadow also models latency and bandwidth using real measurements taken from the real internet. Okay, Shadow is efficient, accurate, and controllable, and runs on a single Linux machine without root privileges, so anyone can easily run experiments using our simulator. So I'm going to talk about Shadow's design briefly here. So Shadow takes as input a simulation blueprint. This blueprint will specify the topology of the network and the general flow of the simulation. Shadow takes the blueprint, and from it extracts several events, mainly when to create the nodes and when to boot up the nodes and start the applications. So once it has these events, Shadow starts processing and starts creating the topology that was specified in the blueprint. As Shadow creates nodes, each node will create additional events that will in turn be executed by the simulator engine. So each of these events occurs at a discrete time instant. Okay. Now, since Shadow uses a simulation blueprint, experiments can be easily repeated. Okay. Also, it's not mentioned here, but Shadow does control the randomness in the simulator, which means if you can give the simulator a seed, a random seed, and as long as you use the same seed and the same simulation blueprint, Shadow will produce the exact same results. Okay, this is important for controlling the simulation environment, for running repeated experiments where you tweak one single variable, you'll be able to tell that the difference in results is because of the thing you tweaked. Okay. So Shadow is controllable. Two other novel techniques in Shadow are the way it manages nodes and the way it is able to run real applications. Okay. So this diagram shows the general process memory space of the Shadow process. Okay. So this is broken up into two parts. On the top, we have the Shadow engine memory space, so the event engine, the node handling, etc. And the bottom part of the diagram, we show the Tor memory space. Okay. So Tor, as I mentioned, Tor is natively executed by Shadow. Okay, this Tor works as a plugin, and so Tor has its normal memory space that it does as it's running as a process on the system. Okay, now in order to manage multiple nodes, in order to handle running several nodes in one simulator using a real application, essentially what we have to do is swap out all the memory spaces where Tor has variable state, okay? So we essentially get the addresses of everything that changes in Tor, and we copy that for each node in our simulator, okay? Then when we want to run a particular node in Tor, we take that node's version of its state that we have copied in the Shadow memory space, and we do what's called a context, sort of like a kernel context switch, where we copy that memory from our Shadow storage into the Tor memory space, and then we allow that node to execute in Tor. Okay. And when that node is finished, when Tor is finished executing with that node, we will copy its state back into the Shadow memory space. Okay. So in this way, we can allow multiple nodes to run in a single simulator with one copy of the Tor process, or the Tor the Tor application. So this By handling nodes in this way, we're actually minimizing the amount of memory that the simulator uses. The only thing that we're duplicating among nodes is the variable state, the state that actually does change during the running of the application. Okay, so this is an absolute minimum on the amount of memory that we're consuming per node. Okay, so now, when Tor is attached in this way and it's running for a node, right, Tor will do things as it normally does when it's running on a system. It will create sockets, it will try to send and receive network information, and do everything else that a system allows it to do. Now, the way we handle this in the simulator is with a technique called function interposition. We use the LD preload environmental variable to intercept these function calls and redirect them to go through our simulated network. Okay. So we've, as I mentioned earlier, Tor runs as a plugin into Shadow. Okay. So we wrote a plugin. This is called Scallion. It's a plugin that integrates Tor into the Shadow simulator. Essentially, what Scallion is a small set of code surrounding the Tor source code that allows it, that contains the necessary hooks to allow it to communicate with the Shadow simulator. So I don't want to get into the details of what is required, some of the tricky issues here. You can see the paper if you're interested. I just want to give a little bit of idea of the scalability of running Tor in Shadow. We can run 1,250 nodes and 10 gigabytes of RAM with approximately a 5 to 10 times slowdown depending on your hardware capabilities. And we've also been able to run 5,750 nodes and 60 gigs of RAM with about a 40x slowdown on our slow server CPU. All of this runs on a single CPU currently. So this is pretty outstanding to be able to run at these kind of speeds and with capability on a single CPU. We are working on multi-threading the simulator, and we hope that this will decrease the runtime significantly. Okay, so. So once we have this, we have Tor running in the simulator, we need to determine how accurate it is. So to do this, we compare the results that we see inside of Shadow with results that the live Tor network gathers. Okay. So we model the Tor network using live consensus from Tor and using other data measurements from the Tor network. So we create what we think is a model of the network, and we run experiments to determine if the performance we see inside of our shadowed Tor network is the same as the real Tor network. So the gray areas on these graphs show the statistics from the live Tor network, and the solid lines show the statistics from the shadow Tor network, from our simulator. So each of these graphs represents a different file size. The blue line in the upper left shows a 50 kilobyte file, the upper right shows a 1 megabyte file, and the bottom graph shows a 5 megabyte file. Okay, so this shows performance as the load, the file size increases. Okay, so the gray area represents the statistics from the live network. The left edge of the gray area represents the 25th percentile of the Tor statistics. The right edge represents the 75th percentile, and the vertical dashed line represents the 50th percentile. So if Shadow was going to match the Tor statistics exactly, each of these solid lines would enter the gray region at 25%, would cross the vertical line at 50%, and would exit at 75%. So I've noted with arrows on these graphs the places where we slightly miss our mark. And even where we miss our mark, it is extremely close. I want to stress here that we were extremely excited when we saw these results, that we're able to accurately model the Tor network this closely. Okay. I also want to mention that it's not extremely important that we precisely match the performance that the real Tor network sees. Okay. What's going to be more important is the relative difference between our simulation runs. Okay, so you run one experiment using certain settings and our model of the network. You tweak some settings, and you run another experiment. And the relative difference between those two experiments, we can contribute the difference in performance to the settings that we changed. Okay, so that's going to be more important here. So in order to demonstrate Shadow's utility, we looked at an algorithm that was previously added to the Tor network. This is an algorithm, a scheduling algorithm from Tang and Goldberg, from CCS 2010. Okay. So they looked at this algorithm using three nodes on PlanetLab. And essentially what the algorithm does is it prioritizes bursty web traffic ahead of bulk traffic. Okay. So the graph on the left shows their results from their three-node PlanetLab experiment. The solid line on the left shows the performance achieved with the prioritized downloads, and the dashed line on the right shows the performance they achieved with the unprioritized downloads. Now, we shadowed their PlanetLab setup inside of our shadow simulator, and our results match their results pretty well, okay? We see about the same increase in performance from unprioritized to the prioritized version of Tor, okay? Now, Tang and Goldberg used three nodes on PlanetLab, and they used what they had available. They used the tools and the techniques that they had available to them at the time, okay? Now that we have Shadow, we can easily test this algorithm on an entire Tor network by using all the relays, having all the relays do this scheduling at the same time, instead of just a small toy network, really a toy circuit on PlanetLab. So we perform this large-scale experiment. In this experiment, we have 950 web clients and 50 bulk clients, okay? So this was what we term as the lightly loaded network. And then for the heavily loaded network, we double the number of bulk clients from 50 to 100. So this produces a significant amount of extra load on the network. Okay, so here are the results we see when every single relay is using the new circuit priority scheduling algorithm that Tang and Goldberg presented at CCS 2010. So the overall point I want to make here is that the new algorithm doesn't change performance over unprioritized vanilla Tor significantly. In all of these graphs, the results are really, really close, no matter which scheduling algorithm you're using. Okay. If you look a little closer, you can see, for example, in the lightly loaded Tor network for the web downloads in the upper left, you can see that there are actually some settings of the new EWMA circuit priority algorithm that cause performance to slightly decrease over vanilla Tor in our simulations. So there also are some settings that cause it to increase. Okay. On the heavily loaded Tor network, in the bottom left, we can see that for almost all of the settings of the priority algorithm, web client performance does get slightly better. Okay. So what this tells us is really it's unclear whether or not the circuit priority scheduling algorithm that is actually in use, being used by Tor today, it's on by default, it's unclear whether or not this is actually helping the network. Okay. And there are settings for this algorithm under specific, under certain loads where this algorithm could in fact be hurting the network. Okay. It's unclear whether or not it's actually doing anything. Okay. So to conclude, we talked about an efficient, accurate, controllable, and repeatable experiment environment using the Shadow Simulator. Okay. Controllable and repeatable are huge, and also we've shown that it's fairly accurate. We are able to run multiple Tor experiments. We can run them on a single machine in larger scale than was previously possible. And we showed some new results from the circuit priority scheduling algorithm that questions whether or not this new algorithm is actually helping the network. So I also want to mention we've talked about Shadow today in the context of using Tor as an application. But Shadow can more generally can run any application that can be written as a plugin to Shadow. It doesn't just run Tor. So Shadow is freely available and usable software. There are several people who are using Shadow to run experiments currently, and it's available on GitHub at github.com/shadow. It's also available on the Shadow website at shadow.cs.umn.edu. Okay, so I hope this was enlightening, and please use Shadow if you have any use for it for running experiments with Tor or with any other distributed system. Thank you for listening.